Hopefully everybody can hear me okay. Great. Welcome to our scientific seminar series at Carey Institute. I'm Dr. Barbara Hahn. I'm one of the scientists here. Happy Thursday to all of our attendees. It's been really wonderful to see folks tuning in from locations near and far, so thanks for joining. If you're new to this series and you would like to stay tuned to our schedule, please check out the website on this slide. And you can send us an email if you want to receive notifications and Zoom links to attend some of our future talks. I think we have a brief hiatus on the 28th, but generally we meet on Thursdays at 11 a.m. Eastern. It's my pleasure today to introduce Dr. Lauren White. Dr. White is a quantitative disease ecologist. She recently joined the California Department of Public Health as a statistician modeler. And in my opinion, they're extremely fortunate to have somebody with such a rich background experience. As a doctoral student at the University of Minnesota, Dr. White was supported by the National Science Foundation through a graduate research fellowship. After completing her PhD in 2018, she was awarded a postdoctoral fellowship at CSINC, which is the National Socio-Environmental Synthesis Center. She then completed a second postdoctoral fellowship, this time as a Science and Technology Policy Fellow, supported by the American Academy for the Advancement of Science. And as a AAAS Fellow, she was working with the USAID Office of HIV/AIDS. Her record of scholarly publication is equally impressive and diverse. She's explored things like the interplay between how animals behave and how this behavior is modulated by environmental change to influence things like pathogen transmission on the landscape. And she's also been involved in developing some really important ideas, exploring the consequences of feedbacks between ecosystem processes like nutrient cycling and disease processes like transmission and host mortality, and then also thinking more broadly about how pathogens can influence ecosystem services in general. So I'm really looking forward to learning more this morning about her work. Her talk is titled The Effects of Heterogeneity in Pathogen Transmission on Disease Modeling Predictions. And I'll just remind the audience that you're more than welcome to ask questions using the question and answer box or to send questions directly to panelists. So without further ado, Dr. White, over to you.
Thanks so much, Barbara, and I really appreciate the introduction and the opportunity to speak. And thanks also to Matt for the organizing. And yeah, so just for context, this will be work that I will be sharing primarily for my PhD and my postdoctoral work at CSINC. And I guess I'll start by framing sort of a general problem, which I think a lot of us are just a lot more aware of as we're living in this environment, this global environment that's really changing as a result of human activity. And we can think about that in terms of, anthropogenic change and effects on climate change and effects on biodiversity loss. But ultimately, there's also this really important component of effects on where diseases are, how they're spreading, and how frequently new emerging infectious diseases are coming to the fore. And what we're also seeing is that patterns like urbanization and intensification are really driving new changes in movement patterns, which can lead to new contact interfaces. So all that is to say that humans, animals, and vectors are encountering each other in new places and in new ways. And I want to remind all of us that, obviously, emerging infectious diseases have sort of come to the forefront as we've all experienced the COVID pandemic over the last 18 months. But prior to that, this has been a concern in the field for a long time. We have infections like Ebola, which are sort of occurring at the nexus of primates and bats. We have, an earlier SARS epidemic in 2003 where wet markets, wildlife markets were species like palm civets and raccoon dogs were really implicated. And then more recently, horseshoe bats is kind of this reservoir, potential reservoir species. And so with this history and sort of this understanding that these infections are not only, possible, but probable, and potentially more likely with anthropogenic activity, mathematical modeling of infectious diseases are a really valuable tool to help us understand pathogen transmission. So it can help us explain observed patterns, predict future trends, think about how we want to look at control measures or sort of different intervention strategies, link data across scales, and even sort of retroactively look at estimating key parameters that we need to know. And so typically we model transmission as a function of the number of susceptible individuals, the number of infectious individuals, and this transmission parameter beta, which turns out encapsulates a whole lot. And historically, sort of epidemiology has this sort of storied history of using and relying on these compartmental or mean field models. And these sort of follow sort of the same assumptions as like an ideal gas sort of assumption, which is that, you know, all particles or all individuals sort of are equally likely to move and encounter each other at the same probability and equally likely to infect one another. And using this sort of storied analytic approach, we can get really useful quantities like the basic reproductive number, R0, which you've probably heard of in the context of COVID. And this is just basically a quantity that relays sort of understanding, you know, how many new susceptible individuals, how many secondary infections result from a single infectious individual in an entirely susceptible population. And so what that means is that the higher your basic reproductive number, the more infectious your disease is going to be. And I'm just going to highlight briefly the SARS basic reproductive number of 4. This is for the 2003 outbreak, because this really brought up a question: if we knew that SARS was this transmissible, as to why it didn't really achieve sort of a global pandemic status in 2003. And so some retrospective work by Myers et al. In 2005, we're really showing through contact tracing that one of the key components here was contact variability. So just to highlight here that, for example, this first individual in red has, you know, a myriad number of contacts where there was successful transmission, whereas this individual here in the middle really only transmitted to one other person. And so it was thought that this contact variability was really a key component understanding why that SARS 2003 outbreak wasn't more successful. And so it turns out that understanding this really all comes back to the sort of fundamental assumptions that go into the transmission rate beta. And importantly, beta can encapsulate several really potentially nonlinear components. The first, again, being this contact rate. So in ecological systems, we can think about this at a local scale being influenced by things like sociality, group size, mate choice. On a broader scale, components like resource availability, host density, and migration. And then once you have a contact, you also have the component of physiology. So this is sort of the conditional probability of transmission given contact. And this is going to be dependent on factors like susceptibility of the host, how much the infected host is shedding, and then actually how transmissible the pathogen is itself. So we've seen that, you know, even just within COVID, and the emergence of new variants like Delta, which became essentially more transmissible through time. And so given these two pieces, contact and then transmission given contact, we can have a successful transmission event. And then something that my work has explored is this sort of knock-on effects of an infection-induced behavioral changes. So we potentially have these feedbacks between once you become infected, your behavior changes, and this changes the contact rates of either you or even your conspecifics and reaction to you. And so one tool that we have at our disposal beyond sort of these mean field sort of homogeneous mixing models are these contact network models that really can capture this variability in contact behavior. And so in these models, we have nodes or vertexes that are representing, you know, individuals or groups or locations. And then we have edges, which are sort of these indicating this tie or essentially sort of a potential avenue for disease transmission between these two nodes. And it's worth noting that while these tools are available, that they really haven't been as widely used in wildlife and livestock populations, in part because it's just very expensive and sort of time consuming to get the data needed to parameterize this extra parameter space. So I'm moving on sort of the broader outline of my talk here. I'm going to be talking about heterogeneity and transmission across sort of these three key scales, The first being this within host, piece, and we'll be looking at both behavior and physiology of individual hosts. Moving into kind of like a metapopulation scale, thinking about transmission rates between subpopulations at the local scale. And then finally thinking about transmission across landscapes. So this broader scale patterns of transmission as a function of things like resource availability and spatial heterogeneity. So beginning with this first piece of within host behavior and physiology, this is some work that came out of my PhD at the University of Minnesota. And what I wanna sort of pose as the key question here is really thinking, as I showed in one of the original slides, that we have these two pieces, the probability of contact and the probability of transmission given contact. And then really asking what happens if there's co-variation, like there's a relationship between those two pieces, and how would that affect transmission dynamics? And so in particular, I asked, what are the effects of on epidemic dynamics when the contact rate co-varies with susceptibility, infectiousness, or infection status? And so to give you some examples of what this might actually look like in the real world, because I know it's not like immediately obvious, and I kind of have to talk through it as well every time I think about this. But if we're thinking about positive covariation between susceptibility of the host and their contact rate, if we had positive covariation, we would expect that uninfected individuals with a higher susceptibility to a pathogen could have higher contact rates. And so an example of this in wild systems would be the Grant's gazelle, which males with higher levels of testosterone expression have more aggressive behavior, so more agonistic interactions, and also higher levels of nematode parasitism. Going the other way, if we had negative covariation, we might expect that uninfected individuals with higher susceptibility would have lower contact rates. And this is kind of a slightly facetious example, but it's one that I enjoy nevertheless. So this is from a study looking at the pro-inflammatory gene expression across the five major dimensions of human personality. So we have neuroticism, extroversion, openness, agreeableness, and conscientiousness. And so essentially a higher pro-inflammatory gene expression here is sort of considered a correlate to like a more functional immune system. And so my immediate thought when I look at this graph is, you know, I'm an introvert, and even before COVID, I didn't really go out a lot. And I like to just blame it on my immune system. Just, you know, my contact rate is lower. All that being said, just this idea, again, correlation, not causation, but thinking about ways that, you know, these two components of susceptibility and contact rate can be related. So for infectious disease versus contact rate, for a positive covariation, we might expect that contact rates increase as an infected individuals become more infectious. And so a really sort of standard application or example of that would be things like the furious version of rabies, where you know, the infected individual is, again, kind of increasing his aggressive or agonistic interactions as a result of their infection status. And for negative covariation, we might expect to see things that as an individual becomes more infectious, their contact rate decreases. And this is kind of maybe the easiest one to imagine in terms of just like standard sickness-induced behaviors like fever, lethargy, anorexia. But interestingly, it could also be a result of conspecifics avoiding sick individuals. So in a really neat study by Croft et al., they showed that healthy guppies were avoiding guppies that were infected with ectoparasites and thus effectively decreasing the net contact rate. So the question then is, like, how can we actually examine these complex relationships? We need something that accounts for individual contact patterns, these intrinsic differences in physiology across hosts, and changes in contact patterns that result from, you know, whether or not you're infected, your disease status. And so to do that, I ended up developing a dynamic exponential random graph model, or an ERGM, as you might hear them called in other contexts. And essentially what we have here is a network that allows for dynamic rewiring. So to show that here, essentially what happens is we have susceptible individuals in blue, infected individuals in red. And what I want you to notice is that not only is the infection spreading across the network, but also that the relationships or the edges between nodes is changing through time. And this is really the key piece that would allow us to get at what happens if you get sick and then your contact rates or your contact patterns change. And then we have, you know, a few recovering in green here. Very exciting. Okay, so if folks are interested, I can go into more details and sort of like the factorial design that we did for this experiment, but I'm going to go ahead and sort of give you the highlights of the results and some of the key things that we saw here. And the first of that is that variability in susceptibility, so essentially just allowing hosts in the population to have different levels of susceptibility, decrease the maximum prevalence that we would expect for the outbreak and increase the likelihood of epidemic fade out. So we saw that we could have essentially a quarter reduction in the maximum prevalence and about one third more likely to have fade out in the case where hosts were just allowed to vary in their susceptibility. Slightly different for infectiousness, and this largely had to do with how infectiousness is coded in the model. But we don't see a reduction in prevalence, but we do see, again, a one-third increased likelihood of having just epidemic fade out at the start of the introduction of the pathogen. So this is without covariation. This is just looking at variability in both of these cases. However, once we do add in covariation, both positive and negative for susceptibility or infectiousness, I'm showing results for, I think, susceptibility here, but they're very similar across these two, is that compared to positive or sort of a null relationship between these, the physiological and the contact rate component, we see an increased time until maximum prevalence. So this time to peak takes longer and also a decreased rate of epidemic spread. And then the thing that I think is really intuitive, but also exciting to really demonstrate sort of mathematically, is that when we allow for this negative covariation between where once you become infected, your contact rate drastically goes down, we really see that negatively impacts the maximum prevalence and how long that the epidemic takes to spread. And notably, this effect is so strong that this rate of reduction of epidemic spread is maintained even at really high values of pathogen transmission efficiency. So we have sort of the transmission efficiency here, the epidemic growth rate on the y-axis. And I just want to highlight that for the highest transmission rate, that the negative covariation context really dampens that potential rate of epidemic growth regardless. So some key points here are that individual variability in susceptibility and infectiousness can increase epidemic variability and increase the likelihood of disease fade out. We also see that negative covariation really suppress the rates of that epidemic spread, even for these highly transmissible pathogens. And that infection-induced behavioral changes can prevent the pathogen from reaching a lot of the population. And this is particularly important, potentially in like a wildlife context for pathogens with these lower transmission efficiencies. So potentially like chronic long-term infections like bovine tuberculosis. For populations with higher contact variation, so maybe some that have just like these longer tails on their degree distributions. And again, just highlighting this piece of negative covariation and sickness-induced behavioral changes, because particularly in wildlife and livestock, these are not pieces that are typically modeled that are included. Again, you know, resolution and granularity of data is a problem here, but it's just something to be aware of in terms of like when we're thinking about making predictions, that these feedbacks do exist and that they're important. All right, so staying again within sort of our within host piece here, I want to highlight some really fun collaborative work that I did with Dr. Pedro Vale and Dr. John Sivajathi from the University of Edinburgh. They are sort of the Drosophila experts, and they've done a lot of really lovely empirical work looking at Drosophila C virus transmission in sort of experimental lab settings. And what we did for this project is we used some of this really great empirical data that they have on social behavior in flies, where we're looking at how many neighbors are within a certain radius, typically of a given fly in a petri dish. And we looked at this at different radii. So to sort of get a proxy for contact network. We looked at once the fly was infected with Drosophila C virus, how much it was shedding. And then we also looked at how long a fly stayed alive post-infection. And so then using these really distinct distributions for these different genetic lines and across sex, we were able to use a contact network model to scale up what a potential outbreak would look like in sort of these simulated synthetic populations. And I think we did a couple of just sort of experimental designs here, but one thing that I just really wanted to highlight was that just allowing for individual, so we have the lines shown in sort of the columns here and the sexes shown in the rows. And so just allowing for these individual sex genetic line combos to have their unique empirical distributions as were measured in the lab, we see really different epidemic patterns. So for example, I wanna highlight the male 818 combination, which sort of like the worst combination to have in this context, but even compared to the females of the same line or say the males of line 373, very different epidemics unfolding. And these are the peak curves, but also just wanted to highlight that we can see this variation also in like individual statistics like outbreak duration. So again, highlighting the differences between male and female 818 line here as an example. All right, so moving a little bit forward, a little bit higher level up to start thinking about between subpopulations at a local scale. So thinking, you know, disease ecology would call these, you know, metapopulations. And for this instance, I'm going to be talking about sort of a totally different system, which is that of swine breeding herds and the pathogen of influenza A virus. And just want to particularly call out Dr. Mansatora Morel, who does a lot of really wonderful empirical work with sort of testing influenza vaccine efficacy in swine, which has made some of this work very possible. So why this particular question or population, you might ask? And yes, so influenza A virus, again, you know, I think we lose track because of COVID, but the H1N1 outbreak in 2009 was quite severe in people. And in the swine industry, there were some retrospective economic estimates that placed the loss of sort of value for the entire industry at around $1 billion for sort of dealing with the consequences of this outbreak in herds. And so we're particularly concerned about pigs in this equation for flu because in particular, pigs are very susceptible to reassortment. So they seem to be pretty good at getting infected from strains from different species. There's been some really clearly documented cases of transmission between humans and pigs. So sometimes you see state fairs getting shut down because there's a new swine flu sort of strain coming out. So that's definitely happens. And then of course, because it's a single-stranded RNA virus and subject to this genetic drift and genetic shift at pretty high rates, we're really concerned about novel strains emerging. And then for those of you that are not steeped in, you know, Midwestern farm culture, what exactly is a breeding herd? So a breeding herd is this farm structure containing gilts, which are young female pigs, sows, which are female pigs of breeding age, and then piglets are, you know, young pigs. And typically in these kinds of structures, piglets are sent to a farrow to finish farm where they get enough weight either to be bred or to be sent to market. And it's also important to note that in these, the context of these systems, that about, you know, 60% of US farms are like these big commercial outlets with at least 5,000 heads of animals per farm, which really makes it sort of this perfect storm of, you know, all lots of opportunities for recombination. There's some really intriguing work done both empirically and in modeling studies that show that piglets can serve as a really important reservoir for influenza A virus. And so in this work, we wanted to think about, you know, how do we actually eliminate infection in this population of continually renewing susceptibles, right? So with this breeding herd, piglets are being born all the time. And so really developed a modeling framework to be able to test different intervention strategies with the goal of reducing influenza on the farm overall and specifically in piglets. As I mentioned previously, you know, sometimes parameterizing these models can be really challenging. One of the exciting things about working in a species that is economically important and that people care about is that we have lots of cool empirical studies to parameterize things with. So we actually have some really nice literature to work off in terms of vaccine efficacy, the effect of maternally derived immunity, and also sort of, you know, even indirect transmission under different biosecurity settings. And then just to give a brief overview of what a breeding herd farm might look like. Typically, they're sort of just subdivided into three units. We would have a gilt development unit where younger gilts would arrive on the farm and grow until they're ready to be bred. The breeding gestation unit where sows are bred and then gestate until they are moved to the farrowing unit where they give birth and then are nursing the piglets. If we sort of build this out into a little bit more of a complex model, we get a metapopulation model with some flows like this. And here we tested a combination of 15 different interventions to try to see if we could get a handle on influenza A virus. So first we played with how often gilts were introduced to the farm. We played with levels of different sort of indirect transmission and isolation between the gilt development unit and the rest of the farm. We just vaccinated gilts upon arrival. We played with weaning piglets earlier. We vaccinated just sows that were about to give birth to see if we could impart sort of some of this maternally derived immunity. Did a like blanket vaccination for every sort of adult pig that was potentially eligible. And then also looked at sort of vaccine efficacy as a key component. So we could have a homologous vaccine that was directly targeting the strain that was currently circulating within the herd, or a heterologous vaccine that would not, you know, have some cross protective immunity, but wouldn't be like just spot on. And so this zero case here is sort of looking at endemic prevalence if we do nothing in our sort of, you know, control case. What we saw is like the most effective individual intervention was early weaning of piglets. And then ultimately what was sort of the most effective was this combination, everything in the kitchen sink tackled this problem by, you know, a targeted vaccine, early weaning of piglets, gilt isolation upon arrival, vaccination of gilts, and then also longer periods of introduction between gilts. And so we take this strategy, we could reduce endemic prevalence by 50% relative to the null case overall. We could reduce endemic prevalence in piglets by 74%. But this only completely eliminated influenza A virus in the herd about a quarter of the time. And so the takeaway is that although we could get the prevalence down, it's pretty sticky. Like once it gets in the herd, it's really hard to get rid of. So all that is to say that this modeling study was pretty consistent with both previous modeling work and previous empirical work that have sort of identified piglets as this high-risk subgroup. It seems to be based on sensitivity analysis in our model as a function of sort of this maternally derived immunity component and how long it actually lasts in the piglets, which is not long enough to be useful. And so our recommendation here, you know, for sort of these production systems is really to use all biosecurity measures that are at at your disposal in conjunction with targeted homologous vaccination or, you know, some of these other sort of new like live immune vaccines that are capable of providing wider cross-protective immunity. All right, so we're making progress. We're getting up to landscape scale here. And the first piece that I want to share is, again, hearkening back to my PhD days at the University of Minnesota. And I want to start this conversation by just acknowledging that we're already aware in the community, this ecology community, that, you know, spatial heterogeneity can lead to nonlinear outcomes in lots of contexts, but particularly, you know, potentially counterintuitive epidemic outcomes depending on the host and pathogen system. And it's also sort of in my review of the literature shows that there's like kind of a dearth between disease models and wildlife populations that specifically have mechanistic models of animal movement behavior. And so this simulation study was generated to really look at this intersection between individual movement behavior and spatial heterogeneity and its effect on epidemic dynamics. So to do that, developed a spatially explicit, stochastic, individually based SIR, susceptible infectious recovered model for a non-lethal pathogen in a closed population. And we generated these binary neutral landscapes via a midpoint displacement algorithm. And these vary both in the proportion of the available habitat. So as we go up the y-axis, we have less resource availability. And also how patchy these landscapes are. So if we kind of go up to this upper left-hand corner, this is our essentially like what we would think of as like a fragmented landscape. So both low resource availability and quite patchy. So we have our landscape, and now we need to dictate how our hosts are going to navigate it. And to do that, we utilized essentially a resource selection function, which had a component governing how hosts would respond to resources. And so this beta one saying how strongly are you selecting for the presence or absence of resources in your immediate environment. Also, how are you responding to content specifics? And so we had two terms here in part to sort of allow for some of these nonlinear effects, because you can imagine that if you're a host, maybe you're attracted to like one individual nearby because that might signal good habitat or good food. But as soon as there are four individuals nearby, maybe that's too much competition. So there's potentially some nonlinear or some compounding effects that we want to be able to account for here. And then overlaying these two components, we have a movement chrono, which basically just says, you know, you're more likely to move to the locations that are closer to you than those that are further away. Now, when we think about how patches are connected on a landscape, there's sort of two key components that might affect what that looks like. First would be perceptual range. So how far are you able to perceive your environment in order to make movement decisions? And then movement capacity. So, you know, given sort of your constitution and physiology, like how well are you able to move and enact on the information that you're receiving? And so for the purposes of this study, we really focused on perceptual range and kind of assumed like a universal movement capacity. So for perceptual range, we looked at sort of three settings ranging from sort of like 4% of the landscape up to 20% of the landscape in terms of how much you could perceive. We had two treatments for host conspecific density, which I think I'll refer to hereafter as low and high host density. Two treatments for epidemiological parameter space. So sort of assuming a constant transmission probability, but varying the recovery rate as either slow, so a longer infectious period, and thus a higher basic reproductive number, or a faster recovery rate, which equals a shorter infectious period and a lower basic reproductive number. So first we wanted to ask, you know, given everything else is equal, what factors determine whether or not an outbreak is successful? And the first thing to note here is that the outbreak data is already heavily skewed. So because we've got, you know, all these moving parts and the spatial heterogeneity, most initial pathogen introductions don't actually spread. But fundamentally, recovery rate and conspecific density were sort of the two most influential factors to determine whether or not the outbreak spread beyond the initially infected individual. And this makes a lot of sense, right? Because you can't spread a pathogen if you're no longer infected, and you also can't spread a pathogen if you don't actually encounter another host. Then we asked, given the cases that did result in secondary infections, which parameters most influenced maximum prevalence and duration? And for here, we really saw that the interaction of recovery, perceptual range, and conspecific density was quite key. So to walk you briefly through these figures, we have recovery on the x-axis, maximum prevalence on the y-axis, host density in our columns, and then perceptual range in our rows. And so for this piece of a lower recovery rate, AKA a longer infectious period, and this high host density and larger perceptual range, we get this longer tail on both duration and prevalence. So we did see that fragmented landscapes could consistently promote outbreaks for both low host density and slower recovery rates, or conversely for high host density and fast recovery rates, which is kind of these interesting extremes. But in general, these effects were most pronounced for larger perceptual ranges. So as a reminder, we looked at these three treatments ranging from 4 to 20% of the landscape. And you can see that, so we have our proportion of available habitat on the X and the amount of clustering on the Y, with this lower left-hand box sort of being the most fragmented. And we can see that the effects of fragmentation really emerge when hosts are able to perceive more of their habitat to make movement choices. In general, we did see more complex dynamics for these situations of high host density, slower recovery rate, and a higher perceptual range. And this is probably the piece that I was most excited about with the study, but essentially in this parameter space, what you see is that these small differences in movement behavior sort of change the optimal landscape structure from the view of the pathogen. So if we just have positive selection for resources, more fragmented habitat is the way to go from the pathogen's point of view. Also true for conspecific avoidance, but it's a little bit more foggy when it gets to conspecific attraction. And we see that this is true for both. This is maximum prevalence on this axis. And then on this next slide here, we're looking at duration. But again, you can see that maybe like intermediate spaces are like slightly better for in the cases of conspecific attraction. We also wanted to compare these final results to models that do assume homogeneous mixing, because it's great to say, oh, you need this complexity, but it's also really important to know like when that complexity matters and when it doesn't. And so here we have sort of the perceptual distance in red for one. So sorry, these are like the squares beyond which you can perceive. And then the homogeneous case is in purple. And you can see that universally we're overestimating with the homogeneous case. Moving on to duration, we also see that the homogeneous mixing model is pretty bad at capturing the skewed at distribution of epidemic duration. But this is really only important in cases where we have a slower recovery rate, because those tails are just a lot longer in those cases. So to kind of recap here, we, using this simulation model, uncovered this threshold where increased fragmentation can kind of counterintuitively promote pathogen persistence. We see that in certain situations in this parameter space, particularly like the high host density, the slow recovery rate, we see these small differences in host movement really result in sort of different disease dynamics unfolding. And then importantly, you know, homogeneous mixing models aren't really capturing these dynamics in these contexts. All right. And then for this final piece on landscapes, I want to zoom out to some work that I did during my postdoc at CSINC. And this work originally stemmed out of my original proposal for this this postdoc, which was to use movement data from a sort of very small urbanized population of Puma in Southern California to see if we could use sort of this high resolution telemetry data to get at contact rates and then thus infer disease spread. And this was a great idea. It seemed like we had a pretty good data set. Once we got in there, what we realized was that essentially, A, we didn't have that many individuals that were collared at the same time. And that B, when we did, we were seeing a lot of territory overlap, but not necessarily a lot of shared space in the same time. And so this is just a movement trajectory showing male 39, whose territories overlap with these two females. They actually don't ever actually have any real-time contacts. This is sort of the ante case for mother cub pairs, where you could really see strong autocorrelation between mamas and their cubs. So all that is to say that, you know, when we look at this population under these different contexts, sort of definitions of like ranging from spatial overlap to very strictly like spatial temporal overlap, those sort of networks look very, very different. And ultimately it wasn't very useful to simulate across just like a bunch of dyads in this population. So in a way that really got me thinking, because even though what I was seeing in this data set was actually like active avoidance in some of these animals, we still know that they both get and transmit some of these pathogens that, you know, in the case of like Florida panthers, which are endangered, you know, like feline leukemia virus can be like really detrimental and has caused some like very severe plummets in their population. And so I started thinking about how this process of dynamic territory formation and maintenance can contribute to disease dynamics in this like a solitary or asocial animal. And then especially in the case of an indirectly transmitted pathogen, because I thought, you know, what if there's trade-offs between signaling for territory and disease risk? And so to get at that question, I started developing a Stigmergy model. And you may not have heard that word before, but Stigmergy is probably most commonly used in the world of like social insects, where you think about like ants or termites, and they use these social cues like pheromones to inform their colony, even after they're no longer in that location, about some like key information. If you're more of a vertebrate person like me, you know, you might be more familiar with patterns like scent marking, scratching, latrines that indicate territory. And so then took the step of thinking about how we would encapsulate that in like a virtual synthetic environment. And so to do that, developed a mechanistic model of territory formation for, you know, this asocial animal. In this context, sort of this mock-up here, we have two hosts that are navigating their environment, the green host and the blue host. And the green host is leaving the scent trail, as is the blue host. The blue host is trying to decide where to go on the next time step, and it doesn't have any information a priori. It's just going to move, and it decides to go down. Thus encountering the scent trail of this green individual. And at that point in time, its direction of motion is constrained away from that sort of signal that this is somebody else's territory. And so what then happens is we get this sort of territory formation, and we also potentially have an exposure event. So if this green host was infected, and in addition to, you know, territory marking is also shedding pathogens in its environment, maybe the blue was potentially exposed to a pathogen on this foray into the green host territory. So that's like a little hard to envision. So I just wanna briefly show like what this might look like. And you can kind of focus on this area up here where you're gonna see the blue, the pink, and the orange sort of just incurring slightly and then sort of retreating from each other's territory marks. So this is dynamic interplay of territory formation and pathogen deposition at the same time. And so we can use this framework to really look at the trade-offs between recovery rate, pathogen load, how long the pathogen stays active in the environment, how strong the scent signal or territory signal is, and how quickly the scent is staying active in the environment. And similarly to the previous sort of simulation study at a landscape level, we see that recovery rate is really important in sort of both outbreak success, maximum prevalence and duration. And then host density and pathogen decay rate were the next most important parameters to consider across these different metrics. So the really interesting sort of takeaway here is that we saw that territorial behavior as sort of mechanized by stigmergy could dampen the maximum prevalence of the outbreaks that we observe. So we have recovery rate on the x-axis, pathogen decay rate in these panels. And on the y-axis, we have the difference between a paired stigmergy and random simulation. Stigmergy driven versus randomly driven movement behavior. And so a negative in this case means that the stigmergy simulation had a lower outbreak peak than the randomly moving simulation. But interestingly, this is the cost of increased persistence. So especially for slower pathogen decay rates and lower recovery rates, we saw that these outbreaks lasted longer for stigmergy-driven movement behavior. And then again, kind of getting into this key parameter space of longer infectious periods, higher host densities, we see some key trade-offs emerge from these other factors that we looked at. So we see highest maximum prevalence when we have a higher initial pathogen load deposited in the environment, when that pathogen takes longer to decay, when the scent or territory signal is smaller upon initial deposit, and when it decays more quickly. We sort of see the converse case, similar pathogen setup. So high initial pathogen load, slower pathogen decay rate, higher initial scent load, but a slower scent decay rate. So this is for duration versus initial outbreak size. So the key takeaway here then is that this territory formation from these indirect cues can offer some protective effects in sort of like the immediate outbreak, but can also result in increased disease persistence, which is like a really important trade-off. So thank you for sticking with me through all of these layers of heterogeneity and transmission. Just to recap briefly, so I know we kind of went into the weeds. When we're thinking about within host behavior and physiology, some of my work showed that variability in physiology, whether it's susceptibility or infectiousness, can really increase epidemic variability, as we saw in the empirical case even of this line 818 male Drosophila. And also that these infection-induced behavioral changes can fundamentally alter how well the pathogen is spreading through the population. And then thinking about this step up, this metapopulation scales, local cell populations, that eliminating a pathogen in a population of continually renewing susceptibles is like very challenging. Obviously, we're concerned about this with COVID and like booster shots and waning immunity. And what does that mean? And what does that look like? But this is really applicable for other systems too. And, you know, understanding these group level differences and like immune response really matter for targeted intervention strategies. You know, in the case of influenza A virus, this is piglets because they have this waning maternal immunity that just doesn't last even if the mothers are vaccinated. And then across landscapes, we saw that, you know, fragmented landscapes can counterintuitively promote pathogen persistence, which kind of points at this interesting intersection between like human activity and pathogens, that small changes in the movement behavior can really alter the optimal landscape from the pathogen's perspective of like what will yield a successful outbreak. And that territorial behavior can protect against the spread of environmentally path, persistent pathogens, but potentially this cost of endemicity. So be really impossible to thank all of the people that have contributed to my research and training. And but I'd certainly like to thank my PhD advisors, again, Dr. Tora Morell for her work on swine flu, my lovely collaborators at the University of Edinburgh, my awesome postdoc mentor, UC Davis Wildlife Health Center for their letting me poke at their PUMA data, and my various sources of funding. So thank you so much for taking the time to listen to my talk, and I would be delighted to take any questions that you might have. Thanks so much.
Thank you, Lauren. That was an amazing journey. I'm so struck by the ways that you're able to creatively parameterize these models, because this question, as you said so nicely in your talk throughout, was just that behavior is so incredibly important and so highly variable that empirically it can be really almost impossible to really understand the full effects of how behavior is going to impact the trajectory of an outbreak or how long it's going to last and ultimately what we do about that. So the Drosophila study kind of blew my mind a little bit, is the fact that they can engineer flies to express different genotypes, and then you can sort of look at that variation. It's just mind-blowing to me. So I have some questions, but I just saw one come in from Clive that I'm going to read to you. And he asks, what do you expect if you incorporated evolution of hosts, like host behavior, for example, and the pathogen? So sort of infusing evolutionary effects into the way that you've been thinking about things.
Yeah, awesome question. Like if you couldn't tell, I'm not an evolutionary biologist, but I think there could be some really interesting interactions, especially if you get at this piece of like infection-induced behavioral changes and that resulting in, you know, actual changes in like mortality. Like if you're able to, part of the reason that you're reducing contact then means that you're able to like conserve resources because you're not moving as much. Or some facet related to that, you could see that like the behavior change could also become inherited as a piece that then like allows you to survive the pathogen and have reproductive success. So I wonder if there'd be some really interesting oscillations and like sort of virulence of the pathogen and like adaptive behavioral changes. And it's not something that I've had a chance to really incorporate, but that sounds like a really cool thing to look at.
Yeah, the question that came to mind for me reading Clive's question is if you have like you said, if you have species that are displaying like a reaction to a conspecific on the landscape, so they're sort of taking cues and acting accordingly, that kind of a system possibly wouldn't allow for a really virulent like host killing pathogen that is also environmentally transmitted, I would think. I mean, theoretically, it doesn't seem probable. And it's interesting also to think about, you know, if we think that that is the case theoretically, then are there, is that backed up by all the systems that we know of where hosts are carving up their environment into territories and sort of infrequently overlapping, you know, maybe just to mate and or to fight each other, defend their territories occasionally. Josh asked you a question, I guess, offline about some work that he did with Rosie Woodruff, which I'll let you look at. Rick Osfeld is asking a question, does the choice of a specific disease outcome affect the generality of conclusions? For instance, would individual heterogeneity affect outcomes like maximum prevalence versus the probability of fade out versus disease persistence differently?
Yeah, that's a great question. I think what some of, like, especially like the landscape heterogeneity work shows is that I guess it seems to be that, I would say that, like, it seems like fundamentally you have to have like some shared characteristics that allow the pathogen to transmit in the first place. So like whether that's, you know, enough hosts on the landscape or like the actual infectious period of the pathogen, which I don't vary in this case, but like could be variable. And it's really like once you have those things in place that then allows there for to be differences in like individual heterogeneity. And so I almost want to say that, like, for example, probably, well, it's hard to draw like universal conclusions, but I think on some level, there's like some other mitigating factors that like might, for instance, make like outbreak success, like less of a useful parameter than say like duration or prevalence as like a metric for looking at variability. But obviously if like you're totally immune or like not susceptible, then that's going to preclude outbreaks as well. So yeah, no, great question though.
Yeah, it's always interesting to think about what metric at the end of a modeling exercise is like the most informative, because they all are informative, but differently informative, which I guess segues to some questions I had about your thoughts on management, you know, especially given your current role with the Department of Public Health in California. I can see a lot of connections between the work that you presented and how we think about COVID, you know, not to generalize too much, but, you know, there are population level, like meta population level differences in behavior, not just things that are easy to understand like vaccine uptake, but also differences in movement and differences in social behavior. And I wonder to what degree you've seen those parallels inform your perspective on the COVID outbreaks and or COVID management going forward. I know it's sort of an open-ended question about COVID and behavior in humans and your work.
Yeah, like I don't want to speak from an official CDPH like hat on, but like I guess personally, like what's been very clear as you were saying is that like different regions, both California and of course across the US, like are experiencing very different epidemics. And I think that's, you know, been traced to like a number of factors. California has done some really interesting work on like equity and how it's related to the epidemic, but also like, you know, yeah, like attitudes and behavior are like really critical. Like are, you know, there's, I'm sure you've seen some of these plots in the New York Times where they like plot uptake rate versus like outbreak for vaccines. And yeah, it's pretty heterogeneous. And so I think we really can point to like host behavior as like a fundamental driver. And, you know, frustratingly, like both good and bad, like we potentially have the potential to, in a public health setting, like change or influence behavior. But it's like in some ways like less controlled than, you know, a wildlife or livestock setting where we can just vaccinate everybody, or like we can control where people or animals go, you know. So like there's that level of autonomy and influencing public health decisions, which is why, you know, like I think if anything my time at Succinct has really taught me, like the social science piece, like understanding the implications of these public health decisions that we put out, it's like really, really key, beyond just having the science.
Yeah, and as you say, like it's not as easy to study as in a livestock setting or even, you know, even in a modeling setting where you're sort of really controlling all the parameters. But even in this, in the breeding farms example that you talked about, it was not possible to eliminate swine flu. It wasn't possible to eliminate H1N1, which even if you're throwing the kitchen sink at it, which really is surprising to me, because I mean, it makes sense theoretically, but what does that mean for even in a controlled setting where you have access to vaccines that are efficacious and you know exactly where all the animals are and who they're contacting and when to vaccinate them and all of that stuff? Still only 24% of the time, what elimination probability. It was really shocking to me. I don't know if you were surprised by that outcome or
Yeah,
not.
no, we were like super disheartened. Like we're like, that can't be right. And like we kept poking at it. Like surely one of these things will matter enough to like knock this out. And I didn't show some of the sensitivity analysis results for that, but really what we saw is that some of these parameters relating to maternal immunity, maternally derived immunity in piglets, was showing that essentially, even if the sows were vaccinated, at the right time to confer immunity when the piglets are born, that the piglets are losing immunity, within like 1 to 2 weeks of being born. And so what seemed to happen is that like, even if you were able to protect all of the, adult pigs, still not like a perfect, just like with COVID, it's not a perfect vaccine. Even in the homologous case, you're still getting some infections. If you have any level of introduction from outside sources, so like those gilts coming into the farm and they have any level of infection, you have enough piglets in that context to just be able to sort of continually reinfect the farm. So it wasn't the, I did present that at a few different like swine conferences, and like a lot of the producers and veterinarians are like, what do you want us to do with this? And I'm like, I'm sorry. I know it's not, but it does. Yeah. So it is quite, it's very, a very sticky setup.
Yeah. Well, I think we could talk about this for a very long time. I see that we're 1 minute over time. I'll let you read the comments in the chat box, but thank you so much for spending time with us this morning and sharing your really, really interesting and intricate work. I think it's really eye-opening, and looking forward to your discussion later.
Thanks so much for having me. I really appreciate it.